Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, thank you, Director Mueller. I greatly appreciate that. Mayor Giuliani, Judge Webster, Chairman Rogers, other distinguished guests, it really is great to be here tonight. And I did not have a chance to spend much time with Director Jim Comey. And it was a great surveillance video, by the way. But I got to tell you, you know, I love his style. He tells it like it is. He doesn't back down. He supports his magnificent agents and all of those wearing the badge. And I think he follows a long line of strong directors, and the FBI is lucky to have him. So again, to Director Comey, who can't be here tonight, thank you very, very much. You know, when I was growing up in Texas, every week I watched the FBI with Efren Zimbalist Jr. Can you imagine going through life with the name Efren Zimbalist Jr.? But to me, he was the domestic version of James Bond. Again, this was 1965. I was 10 years old. But he had a uniquely American slant to him. Zimbalist was calm, cool, and collected. His suit never wrinkled. His hair never wavered. His black sedan was always spotless. He smiled occasionally, but generally had a seriousness about him because, you know, fighting crime is a serious business. His 38 caliber pistol was only pulled out as a last resort. Although, admittedly, on the TV show, there seemed to be a lot of last resorts. He epitomized all that was good and decent about the America I was growing up in. And if I couldn't be a spy, I wanted to be a G-man. 20 years later, I was assigned to SEAL Team 6, and I had the opportunity to work with real FBI agents. It was 1983, and we were just beginning to build the hostage rescue team. And of course, in the 80s, the world was still fighting terrorist groups like the PLO, Bader-Meinhof, and the Red Brigade. And the FBI had established a hostage rescue team to deal with the threat of hijackings, hostage takings, and international attacks. And my SEAL friends decided to join the HRT, guys like Charlie Prouty, Don Glasser. Others later joined, like Court Trailer and Craig Schnazy. These were not Hollywood actors. They were hard, tough men fighting a new enemy, and consequently, it required a new type of G-man. Their suits were replaced with camouflage, their hair was long and unruly, the 38s were gone, and now they carried automatic weapons. But what never changed was their sense of duty to their country. 20 years later, after that came 9/11, and once again, I found myself working closely with the Bureau. I first met Director Bob Mueller in the White House Situation Room. I was a Navy captain and a member of the National Security Council's Office Combating Terrorism, and he was the brand new director of the FBI. We had a particularly difficult international hostage crisis that I was working. Unfortunately, none of the other agencies wanted to take it on. They just didn't want to touch it. But I was pretty passionate in the sit room that day, and the only person that stepped up and said he would help was Bob Mueller, and I never, ever forgot that gesture. And it was only through those actions that the FBI was able to save the life of an incredibly decent and courageous woman. A few years later, I left the White House for the Joint Special Operations Command at Fort Bragg. Soon after I arrived, we invited Director Mueller to come to Fort Bragg for a briefing on what we were doing in the area of terrorism. We knew we needed the FBI's help, but candidly, I was a little reluctant to ask. So after a long briefing full of action photos and wiring diagrams, Director Mueller turns to me and says, "What do you need from me?" So I had my list prepared, and I gave him 7 positions that we need filled. He turned to his assistant and he said, "Let's get them these people right away." And frankly, I was a little stunned. There was no hesitation, just a willingness to help. I recall telling Director Mueller at the time, "Sir, really, this is all we will ever ask for." Within a few years, we had 50 FBI agents working throughout the JSOC network, and never once did the Bureau turn us down. Within a few weeks of that visit, I was in Iraq as a 1-star admiral. Stan McChrystal was a JSOC commander, and our first FBI LNO was Bob Jones. For those of you who know that Bob came in with a high and tight haircut, frankly, that made the Rangers look unruly. I could tell that he had also watched the FBI with Efren Zimbalist Jr. When he was young. But he was incredibly professional, enthusiastic, and more importantly, he taught us about networks, criminal networks that closely resembled the terrorist networks we were fighting. I vividly recall Bob tutoring me on the Gambino family, and as he talked, I could see the parallels. Soon, Stan McChrystal had seized upon this concept, and we began to build our own network to defeat a network. We quickly began to understand the financial component as well. The next guys we brought into Iraq were the follow the money guys. I remember meeting them in Balad, and they seemed more like HRT guys than accountants. They were two young, studly looking guys. And several weeks later, I went down to our safe house in Baghdad, and as I arrived, a Black Hawk was returning from a mission. Much to my surprise, getting off the helicopter with the Delta operators were my two FBI accountants. They were all kitted up, had goggles on, guns, radios, ballistic vests, and they were pumped up after coming off the target. I called them aside, and after a little bit of sailor talk and a couple of whiskey tango foxtrots, I asked them, "What in the hell are you doing on this mission? This is not what the director and I agreed to." But they explained, "Sir, we have to be on target in order to get the forensics so we can follow the money." Well, I knew it was a shallow excuse, but they were part of the team. And I cautioned them that if they ever got shot, I was going to personally come down and kill them. But instead of reining the agents in, they grew in numbers and participation. Soon we had HRT and SWAT guys on target with us to do just what the accountants had recommended, get the evidence. After that, the technical guys showed up. They helped with surveillance. Soon the analysts and the interrogators joined us. And before long, there was not a single mission that didn't have an FBI agent somewhere in the mix. And the FBI liaison officers, well, they were invaluable. I remember my first trip as a JSOC commander now, several years later, was to Sana'a, Yemen. A brand new liaison officer had just showed up the week before. He was an edgy, brash guy, had a New York swagger to him, and he talked like a sailor. I liked him immediately. We got to Sana'a, and it wasn't long before I figured out that the FBI had sent me one of their best, Carlos Fernandez. Carlos had been the unofficial mayor of Sana'a during his time there as the FBI liaison. Everyone in Yemen knew Carlos, and Carlos had the goods on everyone in Yemen. And as we began our efforts to partner with Yemenis, it was Carlos that took the lead. I quickly found that he could talk to anyone, anytime, anywhere, and within a short period of time, they trusted him, just like I did. And it was the same with guys like Kevin Cornelius, Pat Scanlon, Art Zarone, Eddie Deck, and Rob D'Amico. They began to build the FBI network that supported our operations. Within a year or two, all of the agents that had rotated through the JSOC as analysts, interrogators, technicians, finance, or LNOs were now back in the States or around the world. They were SACs from Minneapolis and Cleveland, LA, New York City, the WFO. There were LEAGATs in every Middle Eastern country throughout Africa that would call our analysts when something worthwhile was on the wire. In time, hundreds of agents spread across the globe knew that they could support special operations with a single phone call. It was the finest example of partnership I have seen in my 37 years in the military. The support from the FBI leadership, like John Pistol, Sean Joyce, Mark Giuliano, Art Cummings, Brian McCauley, and others at the headquarters was just remarkable. As time went on and the fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan continued, the agents in the field became inseparable from the Special Operations Forces. I remember getting a call from Sean Joyce, who tactfully told me that Director Mueller was getting a bit concerned about the reports coming out of the field. The Bureau agents, of course, would send a SITREP, a situation report, after every mission. Of course, most of those reports started off with, "We were engaged by the enemy." And I knew that I had allowed it to go a bit too far when one of the agents was wounded and we were getting ready to put him in for a Bronze Star. Consequently, after a little prodding from Director Mueller and a little internal thought, I pulled the agents from direct combat, much to the chagrin, as Director Mueller said, to a numbers, including Art Zarone and others. However, several weeks later, off the coast of Somalia, we strapped an FBI agent to the chest of a Navy SEAL and tandem jumped him into the water to link up with an at-sea staging base. It was just hard to let go. The agents had become our brothers and our sisters, our comrades in arms. But never was this more apparent than during our ramp ceremonies. When a soldier was killed in Iraq or Afghanistan, a C-17 would come to take their remains back to the States. The C-17 would lower its ramp, and the members of the soldier's unit would form an honor guard extending from the ramp, sometimes as far as the edge of the flight line. And off to the side of the honor guard, the VIPs would stand in formation, and along the airfield, other soldiers would gather as well. At some point in time, the Humvees carrying the casket would arrive, and the military pallbearers would walk the casket past the honor guard while Amazing Grace was played by some small three-piece band. At some point, the bugler would play taps, prayers would be said, and all in attendance would come to pay their respect. Invariably, these ceremonies occurred at night, and no matter what time of night, no matter how long they had been working or what the next day held for them, the men and women of the Bureau showed up. The SWAT, the HRT, the analysts and the interrogators, the finance and the tech guys, they all came. They came because they understood what the soldier fought for, and they understood what the soldier died for, and they understood that their sacrifice was never, ever in vain. I tell people my favorite movie of all time is the Christmas classic, It's a Wonderful Life. It's one of those great stories that everybody watches at Christmas. It stars Jimmy Stewart, one of the great actors of the 40s and 50s. Stewart plays a man named George Bailey, who grows up in a small town called Bedford Falls. The movie's set in the 1940s. His whole life, George wants to get out of Bedford Falls and see the world. He wants to do something great with his life. But as time goes on, one thing leads to another, and George is never able to get out of the small town. And about halfway through the movie, George falls on hard times and decides he's going to end his life. He goes to a nearby bridge and is preparing to jump off when God sends him an angel named Clarence. Now, Clarence is new to being an angel, and in order to get his wings, he has to convince George Bailey not to jump off the bridge. He must convince George Bailey that his life has been worthwhile. So Clarence decides to show George what life in Bedford Falls would have been like if he, George Bailey, had never been born. Then there's this great scene in the movie that sometimes goes unnoticed, but it's my favorite scene of all. Clarence takes George to the Bedford Falls graveyards, and there is a headstone of George Bailey's younger brother, Harry. Harry had fallen through the ice when they were young, but George had courageously crawled out on the lake and saved Harry. George looks at the headstone and sees that Harry died when he was just 3 years old. And George looks at Clarence, the angel, and he says, well, that can't be right. Harry not only lived past 3 years old, but during World War II, Harry saved an entire ship from being sunk by kamikaze pilots. But Clarence reminds George that because George was never born, he wasn't there to save his younger brother. And then comes the best line of the movie. Clarence says, and because you didn't save Harry, Harry wasn't there to save the 500 men on that ship. And at that point, you realize that the act of one man saved not only his brother's life, but the lives of 500 men on that ship and the children of those men and their children's children. You see, that's what the agents do every single day. The impact that your agents have is just hard to imagine. They were with us there in Iraq, they were with us in Afghanistan, they were with us in Yemen and in Kenya. They were there when we rescued Captain Phillips and Jessica Buchanan. They stood beside us during compound raids. They stood beside us when we jumped out of airplanes. They stood beside us on the decks of our ships, at our headquarters and in our hospitals, and they stood beside us during the ramp ceremonies. Wherever there was a threat, the FBI was there. Any success that Special Operations had was a result of the great men and women who serve in the Bureau. But like George Bailey, most may never understand the impact they had. They will never know the names of the soldiers they saved. They will never know the Iraqi children or the Afghan villagers that are alive today. They will never know the bombs that didn't explode, the citizens that didn't die, or the leaders that weren't killed. But I guarantee you, their sacrifice, their service, Their fidelity, bravery, and integrity were never in vain, and they have made this nation and the world a safer place to live, and I, for one, am eternally, eternally grateful. Thank you all so very, very much for what you do every day to take care of this great nation. God bless you all.